Let us pray. God, on this night we give you thanks for the gift of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Speak to us this evening, words of life. We ask this in your name. Amen. O Little Town of Bethlehem was written by one of my favorite preachers, Phillip Brooks. Phillip Brooks wrote O Little Town of Bethlehem after he visited the city of Bethlehem in the year 1865. And although we sing this hymn every year at Christmas, I'm almost certain you've missed something that I too missed for a very long time. It's the greatest battle ever fought. Oh, you won't find the Battle of Bethlehem listed among the great battles of history, but chances are, if you overlook the great battle that occurred that first Christmas night in Bethlehem, chances are you are going to miss the real significance of what we celebrate tonight. So, before I proceed, would you join me in singing that first stanza one more time? It's hymn 44, open the books again. Christmas night. Now, of course, Christmas is about more than a baby born in Bethlehem. Christmas is about a battle of great importance, a battle that took place in the city of Bethlehem more than 2,012 years ago, a battle that is linked to any time and any place when our hopes and our fears try to conquer and rule our hearts, our souls, and our minds. It's an ongoing battle, a battle that compels us to choose how we are going to live our lives. Will we live our lives sinking in our fears, or are we going to live our lives thriving with our hopes? Now, most of the time, we live our lives and we ignore the fear that comes when the drums are beating and the bullets are flying and the bombs are bombarding our lives and our world. In fact, we've gotten really good at simply ignoring the battles that are raging in Afghanistan, in Syria, in the Congo, and even in some of our little towns right here in America, and we try especially hard to ignore our fears at this time of the year with all of our Merry Christmases and our Happy New Year. But we cannot ignore that with all the joy and merriment of this season of joy and merriment, that there are still those who are more depressed, more dismayed, more discouraged, more despairing, and more dispirited than at any other time of the year. And we also cannot deny the increase in suicides during this very season when we are singing, O tidings of comfort and joy. Every day, but especially at Christmas, the battle between our hopes and our fears rage on, just as it did in that little town of Bethlehem more than 2,012 years ago. So perhaps if we journey back to that night, 2,012 years ago, when all the hopes and all the fears of all the years met in that little town of Bethlehem, perhaps we can get an understanding of what that great battle was like that night, and it just might help us with our own battles today. Because we know that all the hopes and all the fears of this year and all the years to come come out not only in the dark streets of Bethlehem, but in every place and every time people try to live their lives. And so we hear it in our gospel readings when Luke tells us that in those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world, and everyone went to his own town to be counted. So that first Christmas night, the battle between hopes and fears was in the crowds that came to Bethlehem, hoping that if the census counted them, it just might open up the possibility that they themselves counted. So the crowds came to Bethlehem hoping that the census might signify they were worth something, maybe to the Roman Empire, but more importantly to themselves. So the crowds came to Bethlehem that night hoping that if they complied with Caesar's decree, it would mean their lives meant something. That's hope. But the crowds also came that night fighting their fears. The crowds came to that little town of Bethlehem fearing Caesar's census was counting them in order to control them. The crowds came fearing they were being counted so that the military planners would know where to place the most soldiers in order to maintain King Herod's rule and Roman domination. So that night, in that little town of Bethlehem, the hopes and fears of the crowds were at battle. Luke tells us that Mary and Joseph went to Bethlehem that night, and Mary and Joseph, too, came with their hopes and fears. Mary and Joseph came to Bethlehem hoping that the child the angel told them would be born healthy, happy, and safe. Mary and Joseph came to Bethlehem that night hoping that a place for their baby to be born would be found. They came to Bethlehem hoping they could maintain their relationship through all of the challenges in their lives. Mary and Joseph came to Bethlehem that night hoping people would understand that they really were good people, people of integrity and character. They were hoping, but their hopes were fighting their fears. Mary and Joseph feared the long journey to that little town of Bethlehem might have harmed the child Mary was carrying. Mary and Joseph feared their integrity had indeed been compromised. They feared their reputation was already tarnished, and they feared their standing in the community had been permanently damaged. So that night, in the little town of Bethlehem, the hopes and fears of Mary and Joseph were at battle. Then there were those wise men from the east. David Connell told us yesterday they were actually from the north, but we are not going to quibble about that. Those wise men from the east came to Bethlehem with their hopes and fears. The wise men came hoping they would find the child they were told was born to be the king of Jews. These wise men came hoping they had done the right thing in following that star to Bethlehem. Yes, they came with their hopes, but their hopes were fighting their fears. These wise men from the east feared their journey had been a futile one. They feared the star they had followed for so very long would lead them to no place, and even if there were a place, there would be no child when they arrived. They feared their long journey would be no more than a fool's errand, with three fools walking around carrying gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So that night, in the little town of Bethlehem, wise men from the east came battling their fears. Then there was the unseen presence of Herod the king. Yes, Herod was in that little town of Bethlehem with his hopes and fears. Herod was hoping to maintain the security of his position. He was hoping to retain his power, and hoping that since he had tried to be a really good king, all would be well in his kingdom. But along came these wise men from the east, asking a most provocative of questions: where is the child born to be king? And so Herod's hopes were fighting his fears that night. Herod feared a slip in his poll numbers and the loss of his power. Herod feared being upstaged by an upstart, and he feared his place in history might be compromised after all. And so that night, the hopes and fears of Herod the king was at battle in that little town of Bethlehem. And finally, there were those shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock that night with their hopes and fears. The shepherds were hoping that they could eke out a living for their families. They were hoping their flocks would be healthy and happy. They were hoping none of the sheep would go astray. Those shepherds were hoping that in the midst of the drudgery of sheep keeping, something new might happen in their lives. They were hoping for a new beginning to their lives. They were hoping, hoping, hoping that something might happen to lift their spirits and give them a story to tell that would make their lives more meaningful. But their hopes were fighting their fears. The shepherds feared the sheep would not be okay. They feared being forced to join thousands of others on the unemployment line, and more than anything, those shepherds feared nothing new would happen in their lives, and that their ordinary sheep-smelling lives would end in their sheep-smelling death. Yes, that night in that little town of Bethlehem, the hopes and fears of those shepherds were at battle in a battlefield in Bethlehem when something unexpected did happen. An angel of the Lord appeared to those sheep-smelling shepherds, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and suddenly that dark, nothing spectacular night lit up like the bright light of day, scaring the devil out of those shepherds. But the words of the angel spoke to those terrified shepherds that first Christmas night were, "Fear not, fear not, O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark streets shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight." Tonight, 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 as we gather more than 2,012 years after that first Christmas, we too are gathered like the crowds who came to Bethlehem, like Mary and Joseph, like the wise men from the east, like King Herod and like those shepherds keeping watch over their sheep, we gather tonight with all of our hopes and all of our fears of all of our years. Some of us are hoping we count, but we fear we don't. Some of us are hoping people will understand us, but we fear they won't. Some of us are hoping the choices we make are good ones and will make our lives and the lives of those we love better, but we fear we've made some great mistakes along the way. Yes, some of us are hoping to maintain our positions, retain our status, secure our wealth and power, but we fear losing everything we've ever worked for. So yes, the hopes and fears of all the years still come together in battle today. Sometimes the battle is in our minds, sometimes in our hearts, sometimes in our souls, sometimes the battles are at work or in our homes or in our relationships, just as it was in that little town of Bethlehem that first Christmas night. But what happens at Christmas is that the babe in a manger comes. And when Christ comes, he arranges a ceasefire between our hopes and our fears. At Christmas, a truce is declared. At Christmas, the fighting stops, the troops are withdrawn, and the battle ends. And we declare peace on earth, goodwill to all. Oh, holy night, when Christ was born, we say to the enemy, hold your fire. On this sacred night, we declare an end to the battle, to the violence, to the fightings within and the fears without. Because Christmas comes and the Savior says, you don't have to live in fear any longer. Because what Jesus does when he comes at Christmas is to tip the scale on the side of hope. Tonight, if you are living in fear of what the future holds, I say to you, fear not. Tonight, if you are living in fear that we are actually going to fall right off of that fiscal cliff, I say to you, fear not. If what happened in Newtown makes you afraid of what is going to happen in your town and our town, I say to you tonight, fear not, because we have been given the most incredible gift of God ever, the gift of hope now in flesh appearing. You see, that little child born in a manger that first Christmas night held hope in his hands. And that hope is for you, whoever you are. That hope is for you wherever you are in your life. And that hope is for you no matter what you are going through. So tonight, I say to you, with the authority of God himself, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all in heaven and on earth. I say to you, and all ye nations, rise, join the triumph of the skies, and with the angelic host proclaim, Christ, the hope of the world, is born in Bethlehem. My sisters and brothers, that is our Christmas message tonight. A blessed, blessed Christmas to you. Amen.